Yes, now.
Yes, now, baby. So do we go back where we came from, or do we have to work our way back? We're back where we came from. Ugh.
Enough dawdling. We have a world to see.
Do you mind? I just died. Please, I must be alone. Alright. So we're done here with this lower part.
Of course.
But of course. Oh, Feriok, we gotta convince him to come with us. And, well, Leto is the one that O is talking about. These pipes are pumping fluids from somewhere outside the bar. Someone added the spigots later, so the fluids probably weren't intended for drinking. Hail, Feriok. The bartender is a tall, powerfully built man with nut-brown skin and a bushy beard. He radiates strength and confidence. He moves with speed when necessary and remains almost motionless the rest of the time, like a predator waiting to leap. Yet even when he prepares a drink, he doesn't touch a thing. His brow furrows slightly, and the bottles and glasses lift by themselves. When he sees you, he smiles broadly. Welcome to the Fifth Eye, friend. I'm Feriok. His mind is a careful blank. You can't read anything from him. Can you tell me about this place? The Fifth Eye is a bar for psychics. At least, it is now. In the prior worlds, near as we can tell, it was an old pumping station. All these pipes lead down to some reservoirs deep beneath the city, and they pump whatever is in these reservoirs up here. Anyway, some damn fool started drinking from the pipes, and some other fools started in too. Some of them died, but some got drunk as hell. After a few whiles, vague enough for you, they got pretty good at figuring out which were safe and which weren't, and that's when they figured they'd start making money off the place. Reason psychics flock here is because the building dampens out the psychic noise of the city. He grins. The drinks help too. Leto says, Feriok means to say that he is only involved in the delivery of these drinks rather than their creation. Given his skills, this is only right and proper. Feriok throws a hand across his forehead. I have been maligned by this desert-dwelling interloper. Oh, you know, old pumping station that seems to be cyclically shielded. Strange drinks that we're mixing out of volatile ancient compounds. Occasional safety hazards, and of course a clientele that's more than half cracked. He grins. Does that cover it well enough? You said this is a bar for psychics. What does that mean? Means this is a place where psychics can unwind. Look at that floating. Can't get away from the city. Get away from the noise. You know what it's like to be psychic? Let me paint a picture. Imagine every time you're going to sleep, someone comes and starts screaming in your ear. Or objects in the room start whispering about how they want to burn. Or they might tell you their secret names and how to make them float and dance at your command. Or maybe every person you meet is like a house with all of its doors and windows thrown open, and you can't help but look in to plunder their secrets. And underneath it all you hear their silent judgments, the truths they hide even from themselves. He pauses to concentrate on a floating cloth as it wipes a mug clean. Then the mug places itself on a rack. Okay, so Professor X would love to hang out here. Folks think that it's a blessing to have these powers, and sometimes it really is, especially when you can join your friends to make something great. But, he shrugs, it can be hard, hateful, and you can never tell when you're going over the edge of insanity. I've got much more to say. Talk to the others here. They'll fill your head with stories and pictures. I'd like a drink. You're in for a treat, friend. A real treat. Assuming you call the possibility of a toxic reaction a treat, of course. He points at the various pipes on the wall. We've positively identified some of these as safe. Smaller subset here as inebriants or hallucinogens. We've got a few that are, well, chancy. As in, sometimes they kill people. Cost for a safe drink is 3 shins. Experimental ones? Those are 10. Why are the more dangerous ones worth more money? You figure it'd be the other way around. Let's talk about the chancy drinks. We've got this strange black ichor, thick enough that it's almost chewy. There's a pink sludge that's a known entheogen, but its strength varies and sometimes kills people. We have one that smells like Eltaban fruit, and we sometimes use that one to get rid of stubborn grease stains. It's acidic, but, well, maybe it's an acquired taste. Give me one of the safe ones. He nods and closes his eyes. Coming right up, he murmurs. Glasses and cups float through the air without his touch, moving with precision to the spigots on the walls. One settles before you. You drink it. It tastes like licking a greasy metal pole that strangers have held all day. The sounds around you become muffled for a few moments. Do I dare? The black ichor. I think the pink sludge, you said some people die. I like to try the black ichor. He shudders. I tasted the stuff once. I don't remember much about the time afterward, but I was raving about holes in reality. Well, here's your drink. A strong glass bowl floats under a pipe. A spigot turns and the ichor oozes from it. You could smell it from here. The bowl floats back to you, all without Feriok touching it. Drink fast is my advice, he winks. Lost 10 shins. You put the word to deed. The taste is not unpleasant, though the texture is horrifying. Unbidden, you think of soft flesh rotting under a jungle sun. Nothing happens. At least not right away. Just as you begin to doubt the ichor's efficacy, you feel the earth shift slightly. The walls shiver and begin to shake. Their surfaces look as if they are slowly melting. You feel the weight of the ceiling and sky forcing you to the floor, and only a great effort of will keeps you standing. Rents begin to appear in the flat surfaces of the bar, in the walls. Scabrous tissue rims their edges, and a deathly chorus pipes through in a register almost too high to hear. The world tilts on its axis, and you stagger to the right. Your vision blurs, and the invisible world swims into view, becoming more solid than the world you call home. Oh, crap. What?
Yes, lass?
Are we talking normal? Okay, we're just gonna see a little screwed up or something. Clary needs your help. She's looking for warriors to fight in the endless battle.
I'll remember that.
Ha! Huh. No. No way. This bar is my life and I've done my time. I've got no interest in fighting for people I don't know, for a cause I don't believe in. You go right ahead, but count me out. He pauses for a moment, lost in thought, or communion. You know what? Maybe you could convince Clarion to take her recruiter act somewhere else, if you want to, I mean, but really, what she's doing, and what she's thinking, is pretty offensive. Okay. Come back a mix soon. There's no way I can talk you into this, okay. Let's talk to Leto. Though this woman's face is young, she has been beaten hard by the sun. She wears a tight-fitting skin suit under loose desert robes. Her eyes are a deep and unsettling black, with no whites to be seen. Occasional streaks of light race across them, flashing in the shadows of her hood like stars plummeting from the sky. I am Leto, she says. I saw your coming. Now you are here. Yeah, that's pretty much the order of things. Leto's mind is inscrutable. Your thoughts reflect back at you from a thousand angles, like shining a light onto a mirrored ball. What can you tell me about yourself? To the northeast, in the middle of the Lost Sea, there is a small town called Jerboa. Dwarfed by the magnificence of the oasis of Emrajolios, Jerboa is a poor town dependent on the charity of its neighbor. She nods to the bartender, and he refills her drink, floating a bottle through the air without touching it. I was born in the slums. The Jibra, residents of the city, would sometimes tour our ghetto. One of them saw my eyes and declared me touched by their god, Nikel. They taught me of the deep secrets of their church and showed me how to comprehend the tapestry in my mind. But one day I saw a light flare in Sega's cliffs. Though this city and mine suffer hostilities, I knew that I must brave these dangers, for I saw the darkening storm. She grips your sleeve. I see the futures. I will not be able to return home, but I arrived in time to aid Dama in his struggle against the adversaries. For a time I was able to read the strands to help our team prepare against the adversaries' attacks, but they learned to cloak themselves against me, and all I could see of their intent was a generalized darkness. I am of little use against the adversaries now, but I remain to help against other foes. I am a prescient. Though certain matters are occluded to me, I come from the town of Jerboa, abutting the great oasis of Emrah Julios, and I do not foresee a return to my home in my life. What can you tell me about the people here? I know the stories of my comrades in arms, their past and their future. I have a deep bond with Ziobe, a friendship with Theberos. My respect for Dama knows no limit, and I have fond recollections of Feriok's ready wit. She shakes her head. I wish I could unravel the skein of perception and live in the present, as do many others, but it is not to be, and so I scrambled across the web of time and know the threads of my friends. Tell me any stories about your friends. Of whom did you want to speak? Tell me about Feriok. A seer of pain and love, a great light, his powers, speech, and attraction, an empath, a weaver of hope and reconciliation. The story I love most is this. An angry citizen comes, threatening violence, and Feriok eats his pain and makes a new man in his place. In those old strands, Feriok is my friend. And you mine, Leto. Tell me about Dama. He is the lodestone, the hoverglass, the light that lifts and the rope that binds. His strength is our strength, and through him we become stronger. He is the caller, the bringer, the tactician, and the strategist. He brings us to this place, and in the future he is God. She does not see you as she speaks. The unseen adversary claims him unless... No, the probabilities are too low. She shakes her head, bringing herself back to the present. Is he still here? She slashes a glance toward a man in a blue shirt and breathes a sigh of relief. Tell me about Ziobe. She gives herself too little credit. During the Cobalt Breach, she erects a shield around her company and fires precise bolts of telekinetic rage into the attackers. She destroys their inhuman captain, hurling him from the walls into dark space, and then dismembers the attackers who have come for me. In that day, she is my hero. She is the only one of us who can touch the physical world so completely. And when Dama dies, she stands to unite us. No. Wait. This isn't real. Not yet. She slaps herself lightly and mutters, "Walk in this world, Lena. This world alone." Seeing the future? Or an alternate reality? Tell me about Theberos. He follows the trail of the words of Kra. He finds the dead village. In his mind, he seals the words, and they chew him to pieces until his brain has lost their knowledge altogether. She looks across the bar to the old man. No, that is a past possibility. That is not this reality. His mind is still intact. His stories still resonate. Is this the world in which he buries the last of his words of Kra? He's very confused. She shrugs. But he is the man who helps plan our battlefields. He shapes our expectations. It is he who brings the first adversary low. It shows him a story, and he tells it a better one. It bows to his vision before it knows his strength, and he traps it. He is a hero to this reality, although he knows it not. I have spoken all the stories I will tell. Nope. What can you tell me about the adversaries? She spits on the ground. I waste water speaking of them. I do not know what they are, but I know what they represent. They are the death of possibility, an existential threat to humanity. They sweep minds into themselves, consume individuality, and worship power. And they have learned to counter mine. I am helpless against them. I do not wish to speak of them. They are the enemies of consciousness. If I could stand against them again, I would show them images of lush and green worlds, possibility spaces that burst with freedom and peace. She shakes her head, alas. How did you know I'd be coming here? Skeins of lives weave together in a tapestry. Your thread glows. It emerges from the sky, and a great darkness follows in your wake. She waves a hand as if pushing through cobwebs. I have seen you. Where you go, that is beyond my powers. Can you tell me anything about the people I travel with? Oh, interesting. Ask, and I will tell. Calistairs. She turns her unsettling gaze onto Calistairs. You are in many realities, Singularity Seeker. In some you destroy yourself. Others see you triumphant over ashes, or you subsume yourself in yourself. She shakes her head. Glittering possibilities, few probabilities. Calistairs says, can you tell me the steps that lead to my destruction? What do I do to succeed? Your future shifts even as you ask the question. The sisters to your right seek advantage. The ones to your left, compromise. You are on the edge of the blade. Your choices are yours, and your future echoes through realities. All you need do is step. Scalastez says, you're trafficking in supposition and simile. What makes you any better than a hedge witch prognosticating in lack entrails? What makes me different? She smiles wide. I actually see the future, Calistairs. Your path is fraught, and you are your own worst enemy. I've already spoken of her. Tell me about Tybir. For the Gallow Glass, I have only one prediction. Change your ways or live with your regrets forever. Forever? That's a long time, my dear, and I'm told nothing lasts that long. She turns her head toward him and looks away, shivering. I have spoken. Tell me about Eretus. He says, yes, tell me about me. She frowns at him and pokes a finger at the golden glow that surrounds him. She snatches her finger back as if burned. His future is bright, but short. After a moment, Eretus bursts out. Was that it? I expected to hear something about fighting Sarax or leaping heroically onto a flying vehicle and wresting the controls from its savage pilot. I do like to fly, you know. I'm a very good pilot. That's the kind of thing I wanted to hear about. The faintest touch of a sad frown at the corner of her mouth is her only response. Interesting, we have the option to ask again, but she doesn't answer. Yeah. A being named O is here to give you a vision. It says you will be the mother of empires. She stares at you, her mouth opening slightly. Her eyes flicker across the bar, landing on no one in particular. I have not yet received the vision, and... A mother? Me? She shakes her head. I am barren. I will give no life. She pauses. Her hands are shaking. She whispers. I see only a stain when I look at myself. Nothing more. A miasma occludes my vision of myself. Huh. I am looking for warriors to join Clarion in the endless battle. She thinks you'd be a valuable ally.
I'll remember that.
Dama is still here, is he not? I follow his lead. He believes one of our old foes is still present in the city. And if he believes it, I do as well. I will not abandon him should he need me. Will you reconsider your decision? I have told you. I will not leave until Dama has resolved that our old enemy is gone. As you wish. You can hear liquid coursing through these ancient pipes. This whole building seems to predate the Ninth World.
Why not?
So this is Clarion. Okay. How do I get over here? Oh, I can just walk down. Alright. This fancy couch might have come from an aristocrat's house, except for the stains and the stink of vomit. Nice. This booth was once a metal tank that held some sort of liquid. Sir Arthour. This man has leathered dark brown skin and hair as white as the full moon. He peers at you from beneath long strips of eyebrows, sucking on a long pipe that has been made from either segmented wood or the leg of an enormous insect. His clothing is blue and formal, like a priest or a professor of some kind. All over him, on his belt, in every pocket, on both shoulders, even hovering in the air around his head, are glowing, chittering devices of all kinds. There's a lot of people who have things flying around their heads. Orb things. Rats in spheres. Let me guess. He sucks from his pipe. A ball of green steam floats away from his mouth. You're a traveler, that much is clear. An explorer. Yet you have the look of a farmer visiting a teeming metropolis for the first time. He taps various relics on his person. Never seen the like, have you? Fortunately for you, I adore educating folks on the subject of the Numenera. I've also traveled extensively and seen much of the world. Go ahead, ask me whatever you would like to know. A metallic bug-like creature perched on the side of his head begins glowing. It crawls into his ear, and he pauses as though listening. After a moment, the bug scuttles out and resumes its perch. He leans forward and lowers his voice. So you're a mind reader, eh? Well, I won't hold it against you. But old Arthur wouldn't walk into a bar of psychics without mental protection, so don't expect to read much from me. How'd you know I could read your thoughts? Nermont told me. He points at the bug now burying itself in his shock of white hair. He can detect that sort of thing. And then this one blocks it. He pulls a circular device from his pocket. I don't like letting people know what I'm thinking. Too dangerous. He puts the device back into his vest. There's the new disc, of course. My first psychic blocker used to melt brain matter. Provoked people to no end, especially those who didn't know their friends were psychic. Who are you? Goodness, forgive me. He stretches out his hand. Sir Arthour Torment, traveler, explorer, and lifelong student of the Numenera. I have seen everything between here and the Steadfast, and I have studied Numenera of all kinds for decades. There is no man more knowledgeable about the Ninth World than he who sits before you, I assure you. Why are you here? Knowledge, of course. I have traveled all over the Steadfast and the beyond, but I had to know what was beyond the beyond. Who knows how much time I have left on this world? I wanted to see for myself. Why are you here in this tavern? Libations. He lifts his glass enthusiastically. I'm trying to determine the nature of these fantastic liquids. Also, the people here are quite informative. No better place to learn about a city than its taverns. He takes a deep swig from his glass. The Sagus Protectorate of the Fifth Eye? Ah, either way, the answer is knowledge. He takes another swig from his cup. What are the Numenera? His eyes light up, as too do a number of devices on his person, though you cannot see why. The Numenera are practically everything around you. We live among the detritus of uncountable civilizations, many of which were more powerful than you or even I can imagine. Everything they left us is the Numenera. Weapons, power sources, medicines, shells, plants, animals. Why, even the very drit in the ground and shins in your pocket are examples of Numenera. Drink. It's such a broad term that the Order of Truth has categorized the Numenera with terms like oddities, ciphers, and artifacts. Of course, any true student of the Numenera considers these categories too broad still. I have my own distinctions, but that is neither here nor there. He takes a puff from his pipe. In any case, it is the Numenera that power the wonders of the world, from the explorer's esoteries to the data sphere, to the drinks in this very tavern. What's the difference between oddities, ciphers, and artifacts? He takes a long puff on his pipe before answering. For the most part, he says, those terms refer to how useful a device is. It makes sense. As wonderful and powerful as the relics of the past are, nobody in this world gives a damn unless it can fix their problems. They don't care how it works or where it came from, eh? But if they can use it to feed themselves, fight off an errant grask, or at least get them a few extra shins, now they're interested. He shows you the back of his fist and sticks out a thumb. Oddities are the useful. The least useful. They do something all right. Heat your drink, float in the air, make everything you say sound like music, whatever. But it's rarely something anyone can get any utility out of. Oddities are fascinating, but pragmatically they're only worth a few shins. Yeah, that cube gave us quite a bit, though. He points... I've been reading too long, guys. I just want to finish up the tavern. He sticks his pointer finger in the air next to his thumb. Ciphers, now, those might do anything. Heal your body, shoot a blast of flame, teleport you somewhere safe, and so on. But they're volatile. Whatever they do, they'll do it just once. And if you don't know what you're doing, putting too many together can give you what's called cipher sickness. He puts up a third finger. Artifacts won't do that. That term belongs to devices that last. Maybe not forever, but more than a one-shot. Some of the most famous weapons and armor in the Ninth World are actually artifacts from prior ones. What's cipher sickness? Terrible. Just terrible. He sets his pipe down. Ciphers are volatile devices, as I told you. If you know what you're doing, you can separate, insulate, quarantine, thus carrying more ciphers than your average explorer without ill effects. Something on his person starts chirping. He taps his pocket to stop it, but otherwise pays it no mind. If you carry more than you can handle, those ciphers react in unpredictable ways, draining your energy, wearing you down, or worse. He leans forward conspiratorially. This one time I saw a cluster of ciphers bond to each other and gain what I can only describe as sentience, rip my assistant to pieces before tearing off into the cold desert. Haven't seen it since. He picks up his pipe and sticks it back into his mouth. It was completely unexpected. I felt bad about that assistance, but, well, science and all that. He shrugs. Fortunately, most effects of cipher sickness are temporary, easily cured by getting rid of some ciphers. If you carry more ciphers than you know how to handle, they can make you sick, draining your energy or worse. It probably won't kill you, but, well, that's what they said about the Fang Devery we stumbled upon in Serdan's past, too. What is the datasphere? It's difficult to say exactly. At a most basic level, the datasphere is information stored within the air itself, but it's much, much more than that. Several of the prior worlds created similar devices of knowledge around or throughout our world. Our term datasphere encompasses all of them, the connections between them, and the effects thereof. For example, he lifts a knobbed finger. People talk about glimmers, visions from another place or time. These are actually some portion of the datasphere accessing human minds. Some ciphers, even some nanos, can access arcane knowledge from the datasphere. Why, even so-called telepathy is sometimes two people communicating through the datasphere without realizing it. The datasphere as a subject of research is far too large for several lifetimes. Alas, I have only been able to spend my time delving into devices that seem to use it, but not the datasphere itself. Or rather, the various incompatible networks that comprise the datasphere. Perhaps someday. Calistez had been leaning in, listening intently, and leans back with disappointment etched across her features. It is a worthy field of study. I had hoped that we might share our knowledge. Perhaps when you've acquired several lifetimes, as I have, we will speak further on the subject. What we call the datasphere is actually several networks of information, possibly more than just information, but that's my own conjecture. Some ancient relics or even people are able to access it, or be accessed by it, giving them arcane knowledge or esoteries. He sucks on his pipe. Or merely driving them insane. You never know. What are esoteries? Esoteric is the common name for any of the various powers or abilities that cannot be explained by our understanding of science. Nanos are capable of esoteries more than most, but other people, and even creatures sometimes, exhibit powers that we would call esoteries as well. Inexplicable powers and abilities some people have, most often performed by some connection to the Numenera. What are shins, exactly? He peers at you over his glasses. Ah, you're new, aren't you? Shins are currency. The Aeon priests believe that some very ancient prior worlds use specific metals or crystals as currency per their rarity. But of course no metal is truly rare anymore. Half the nanos I've met can transmute metal into crystal. Why, I once transmuted flesh into gold, though not entirely on purpose. Anyway, rarity is useless as a means of value, so the value of shins is necessarily a social construct. Shins can be any coin-like object or jagged bit of interesting material, though I think you'll find there is remarkable agreement as to what does and does not constitute a true shin. Many realms in the Steadfast actually mint their own money, but you'd be hard-pressed to find a traveling merchant who didn't accept anything you had on you at the time. It's just currency. It only works so long as we all agree it works. A shin can be any coin-lock object or interesting bit of material. You can sometimes scavenge shins from debris, but no one has ever become rich that way. A sheet of iron is worth far more than the shins you can make from it, for example. How is drit part of the Numenera? Run your hand through the soil, girl, and you'll find it's hardly soil at all. It is filled with the microscopic remains of ancient, unknown technologies and structures, commonly known as drit. Why, in some places, the drit is even alive. He takes a sip from his mug. I don't recommend sleeping on the ground in those places, by the way. Terribly unnerving for the survivors. What's the order of truth? It's what you might call an organized religion, except it's not a religion. All members of the order call themselves priests, and their founder, the Amber Pope, but they don't worship anything per se, except perhaps their own intellects. I understand this town has its own branch of the order. They could answer your questions better than I. All right, how would you categorize the Numenera? Ah, a fascinating question. He sets down his drink and leans forward. I'll give you the brief version, because you obviously have places to be. Put simply, I am less interested in how useful a device is than in its means of function. He takes a quick puff from his pipe and sets that down as well. Now, the technology of the prior worlds is far too incomprehensible and varied for us to truly understand which civilizations created what, but we can define some basic categories. This is the short version. He counts each one on his fingers. Many devices deal with fundamental forces, gravity, magnetism, sound, light, even time itself. Automatons and created intelligences fall under artificial life. Biotechnology covers a wide variety of Numenera. Many plants and animals that we consider natural were in fact created by prior worlds for some arcane purpose. The bloom may fall under this category. Someday I'll hire a team to find out if I can find anyone reckless enough. There are chemical devices as well, as well as those dealing in various forms of matter, metals, liquids, crystals, and conversions between the three. His eyes light up. The most interesting are also the most esoteric. Nanotechnology, which covers much of what common folk consider magic, transdimensional tech, and technology related to the datasphere itself. He leans back, reinserting his pipe. But these are just the classifications I prefer. The Numenera defy definition. Okay. Ask about something else? Of course. Ask away. He leans back and takes another pull from his pipe. How do you know so much about the Numenera? Cipher gathering was always the main source of income for my family. Alas, no more. But I have extended that pension into pure research. It is not arrogant to say that mine is one of the greatest laboratories in the Steadfast. Why, an entire university has sprung up around my home. I specialize in research and experimentation. Prospective assistants apply almost daily, which is good considering how quickly we churn through them. I'd like to know more about the world. Of course. Ask me anything you like. I've traveled all over the Ninth World, throughout the Steadfast and the Beyond. I even know a little about this part of the world, the so-called Beyond the Beyond. I've met explorers of all kinds and listened to countless stories. So what is it you'd like to know? Good God. What can you tell me about the Steadfast? Much, my friend, much. Too much, in fact. The Steadfast is a collection of kingdoms and principalities far west of here, all the way at the end of the continent. He blows smoke from his mouth. It forms into a purple ball and drops to, and then through, the floor. Really? It is where the Order of Truth holds sway more than anywhere else. There are several different kingdoms, along with scattered villages and aldeas, but they all swear fealty to the Amber Pope and his Aeon Priests. He utters a small growl. The Order requires nobles of the Steadfast to fight against the Gaians, supposedly a cult to the north. I have never been there myself, so I don't know the truth, but it sounds like a waste of lives and resources, if you ask me. That's why I keep my laboratory in the southern reaches, as far from the conflict as possible. He sucks on his pipe thoughtfully. Granted, the Order did ask me to leave after several incidents, but I was planning on moving anyway. So it's a collection of kingdoms and principalities on the western end of the continent. It is the seat of the Amber Pope. It is also the seat of the famous scholar Sir Arthour Turin. What can you tell me about the beyond? A wilderness between the Steadfast and here. Highly dangerous. His words seem to frighten, but he has an excited glimmer in his eye. Some of the most interesting claves and villages can be found there. I found one village whose people hovered over a meter of the ground from birth to death. The villagers of another would tell you the exact method of your future death. I can't say how accurate they were, though several of my assistants tendered their resignations. Farther out is the realm of the most deadly creatures, landscapes, and weather. Oh, yes, he says, seeing your expression. The land and weather itself will rip you apart in several locations in the beyond. You've heard of the Iron Wind? It is but one of the cruel rulers of that land, though perhaps the most infamous, a cloud of invisible machines altering the physical structure of anything and anyone it touches. Really? That's what that is? He grins widely as he brings his cup to his lips. Truly terrible. So it's a wild place where the Numenera holds sway more than humanity. Some few communities find ways to survive, but most explorers find travel very difficult. He takes a contented puff of his pipe. Most. What can you tell me about the areas beyond the beyond? You're in it, friend. They call it the Sagus Protectorate, or at least this portion of it. There is Sagus Cliffs and the Bloom nearby. I've heard of places like Haref and Emrah Jolios far to the east. I'm most interested to explore this valley of dead heroes I've heard so much about. A place to inter the dead? Bound to be some very interesting relics in a place like that. In truth, I am only a recent arrival to this place myself. You would do better speaking with the locals. So I can't tell you much, I'm afraid. I'm looking forward to visiting parts of it myself. Blah, blah, blah. Well, can you tell me about different kinds of explorers? Brave and intrepid souls, my friend. Explorers come in all shapes and packages, but I think you will find that most people prefer to label the bravest explorers as glaives, nanos, or jacks. Glaives are the elite warriors of the world. Nanos are those who study the Numenera, using it to perform powerful esoteries. He takes a yellowish ash from his pipe. Jack is something of a catch-all term. They're mostly pragmatic folk who know a little fighting and a little Numenera. Jacks of all trades, as it were. But explorers of any stripe are useful to have around, especially if you're expecting trouble. Well, it's unfair to put people into a box, but in truth, that's what most people do. They prefer to think of the most fantastic explorers as either fighting glaives, esoteric nanos, or jacks of all trades. Why do they call this the Ninth World? An interesting question. He takes a preparatory swig from his cup. One would think it is because eight worlds came before us, but even a cursory study of the Numenera reveals far too much breadth and variation for there to have been a mere eight prior worlds that created it all. Really, there's more? One then might ask what qualifies as a world. We could say the first through eighth worlds are defined as the most powerful or influential civilizations of their eras, but even that falls under the most basic reasoning. If the previous eight worlds we refer to were the greatest of the ancients, then what qualifies this world, wherein we cannot even understand the most basic theories governing a time auger, to be the ninth? The truth, I'm afraid, is that we call this the ninth world simply because that is what we have decided to call it. No more and no less. I believe it's because that's what we decided to call it and no other reason. Okay, I'm finally done with this guy. And safe travels to you, madam.